You guys can see my screen? Okay, perfect. Great. All right. Well, welcome, everyone. I know most of us are on the West Coast, but there are some folks dialing in from other parts of the country and also from Europe. But I wanted to formally introduce Dr. Francisco del Piñal, who is our virtual visiting professor for today. And he's been kind enough to join us at 10:30 p.m. his time after his twin son's birthday party. So thank you so much for doing that. Just by quick way of introduction, most of us were on the call on Wednesday when Professor Raja Sabapathy gave a replantation talk. And one thing I found out during my travels last year, when I was in India, I saw this picture and I found out that Paco and Raja were actually co-fellows in Louisville together in the same year. So so that's a tremendous coincidence.
He left the hair sometime.
That's right. So it's tremendous coincidence to have such great world-renowned experts be part of the same class. I had the privilege of flying to Spain last year and spending some time with Paco in both Madrid and Santander. He has practices in both cities. And I really got to see him, his magic firsthand. And this is the view from his operating room. I challenge anyone to come up with an operating room in the world that has a better view than Paco's OR in Santander. So this is literally from, you know, from my camera, and it's an incredible view to have. And I had the privilege of actually operating and scrubbing it with him and assist him in a toe hemipulp, and I really kind of saw everything up close. And he truly is a master at his craft, at a lot of aspects of hand surgery, not just microsurgery and toe to hand transplants and the mutilated hand, but also wrist arthroscopy and fracture management. So he really is the complete hand surgeon. I also had the privilege of meeting his beautiful family. As I mentioned, his twin son's birthday was tonight. And of course, Spanish hospitality being what it is, he and his wife were incredibly hospitable, and I had the chance to meet his partners as well. And so I want to formally again thank Paco for joining us. And I'm going to go ahead and give you the controls now, Paco. So
thank you.
It'll just take me 1 second here. And it looks like we are, let me just find you here. There we are. The more people join, the harder it is to find the person to give the controls to. Okay, so you're going to get a prompt now, the presenter, and you can share your screen, the button down below.
Yeah, okay. Okay, okay. So tell me one thing. About what do you want me to talk? Because I have several things. So the small talks I can talk about, I mean, they invite me to, they told me they want me to talk about total hand transfer, which is funny to talk about total hand transfer to the clinic where the toes started, because it was the, you know, Dr. Buncke was pioneer without any doubt about this this topic. So it's quite an honor and also a challenge.
So, no, I think the toe to hand would be a great topic because even though obviously there's a lot of history here with the toe to hand transfers, I think that you have really refined the process and do some beautiful work with your toe to hand transplants. So we can potentially start with that and then we'll go from there.
Yeah, there will be all is about toe to hand transfer. Okay, so
okay,
but I have a thumb, I have a I have a metacarpal hand. I have several things. Okay, so I'm going to start about the thumb. If you think that's it, let me check this where to find myself. So I have to. I guess I have to say here screen, right?
Yes. But, if you click on screen, then we'll be able to see it.
Go to the meeting room. There's something that says. I have to. I guess this is okay now. Can you see my screen now?
Yes, we can see your screen.
I
perfect.
See my screen? Yeah, okay.
Beautiful.
Okay, so. You get it now? Okay. So there are several, you know, toe to hand transfer is has a big, long history, as you all know, and there's been many ways of reconstructing. You know, there's but there's only one way of reconstructing a thumb well, which is by doing a thought transfer. There are several options in the literature, but this is like this, you know, this this guy has been 30 years like that with a groin stick in here of his on his thumb position, and suddenly he found that there was other alternatives. Like there are many ways of carrying the same operation, and he thought he had a good thumb reconstruction. Like you have another ways of doing surgery. There's a vasectomy, and you can see that after a toe, the guy is using his thumb for real fine activities. Another possibility is a Brunelli flap, and the guy came over and thought that he was a sloppy reconstruction. So we put back the Brunelli flap to position and put a thumb. Another possibility is that there are in the literature is a lengthening. This patient has been 16 or 15 years looking for an alternative, because although he had something done, he was not happy. So we, this is the bone after the lengthening. So what I did was to shorten that metacarpal and put a toe on top of that. And so that's the difference between what he had before and now with a thumb with motion at the level of the MCP joint. Okay. So are you getting me? Are you getting my Bovac?
Yes, it's perfect.
It's perfect.
Yeah,
okay.
Perfect. Yeah.
So you all know about thumb reconstruction. So what I would like to talk is about a bit different options in complicated things like because extend thumb to me is not a normal thumb, is when there is a soft tissue defect, particularly at the web, when there is muscle issues, or when the loss is very proximal. And in the literature, basically what they offer you is to do a polycization or two stages. They love two stages, groin flap plus toe transfer and then tendon transfer. I prefer to do all this in one stage. And I'm going to talk about bit by bit first of all, and then I will talk about everything. And there are several ways you can reconstruct the web. At the same time, you can reconstruct a thumb. This patient had this index finger was non-vascular, I mean non-vascularized. It has no sensibility. And you can see the IP joint is destroyed, and so you really the index was functionless, and we as you can see there is no MCP joint, which is very important, because if you end up losing the MCP joint and the IP joint, the thumb won't function very well. So a way to restore the MCP joint function and to have a good web is by transposing the MCP joint of the index, which has actually not much use, and then that's the operation. Here we this pedicle, okay, in one stage, and we preserve this artery. Can you see my arrow here moving at the same time?
Yes, we see it.
Okay, okay, good. Okay. So this we preserve this artery, this like half a centimeter. And we transpose this on the skin bridge, and on that artery, so we suture the muscles obviously because we want that to be functional. And in that artery, to the radial side of the middle fingers is where we hooked the toe transfer. Okay. Also, we would like the index is too narrow, so in order to make it larger, it's a good idea to make one incision and to do like a Y to V principle, which is the opposite to a VY. Which everybody knows, but in plastic surgery there is a similar principle, which is the opposite, which is the Y to V, in order to widen things or to make them larger. So that's the idea of the case, okay, with all the vessels and so on, and that's the result. Okay, and the donor site should be here somewhere. I can't see that because it's covered by parts, but supposed to be here, the donor side, which is instead of to have to harvest the whole hallux, you only need the very distal part. The other problem of the web, can you hear me okay?
Yes, yes, we can hear you perfectly.
Yeah, okay, okay. Because I hear sometimes echo, so I don't know whether it's, you get me okay. So the other, sometimes the web is much more complicated than actually the thumb. This patient has two, she had an electrical burn injury, and she had the web totally contracted. And that's her left hand, where this is the MCP joint, which is exposed, no flexor tendon, no vessels, no anything. So for this case, we were not going to fight too much. We're going to do a filleted flap on the dorsal vessels, because there are no volar vessels and no nerves or anything. Everything is charred by the injury, but we were able to restore the web, okay, with just one single operation. And at the same time, on the other hand, we, as you can see, the web contracture can be as bad as to not having a thumb, because you lose the function totally. So what we were going to is to restore, first of all, the index, because we couldn't do, obviously, in this this patient who already had an amputation, we couldn't resect the index finger for her case. So what we are going to do is to use a kind of a filleted flap from the middle finger to cover the volar defect of the index. Because you have to, I underline for you that there is no nerves, no arteries of the index, okay? Everything is surviving on the dorsal pedicles for the middle and the index finger. And one thing we do for those cases is to transpose the metacarpal and to put some screws here, and that works pretty well. Okay, so we put we didn't put a rod in that stage. We only put that flap, and then you see the fixation. You actually, in this case, we didn't, but you can start French motion with these two screws. So this is immediately after the operation. So I think 2 months later, that's the flap here. And now we have the index with the length restored. But remember this finger, this index finger does not have sensibility nor broad supply. There's dorsally days. So, and at the same time, we have the web problem and this bone exposed. Okay, so we're going to do a very complicated operation, but it's very easy to explain to. And even it's not complicated to do it, but just because there is a septic arthritis, we're going to do a fusion there. That's the web opening, and we are going to do a transfer of the web. Okay, another way of restoring the web is by using the web. In this case, we needed a large web flap, and we have as the first web, and with in a flow through manner. Okay, because we want not only to restore the web, but we would like also to restore the blood supply and the innervation of the index. Okay, so this is a bit the idea. We hook this flap comes from the tibial side of the second toe, the contralateral foot. Okay, and so we connected the nerve here proximally where the stump was, and distally to the in the index finger. At the same time, you can see there is revascularization of the index and also of the web flap. Basically, went from this situation to this other situation, and from this function to this other function, and this is it. And the donor side is quite forgiven. We use split thickness skin graft here, and also in this side. Actually, I told you that I harvest from the second toe, but we harvested in this case from the peroneal side of the hallux. But the principles are exactly the same. It's a neurocutaneous flap. In this case, flow through nerve and arterial. Well, this is a special case because she's a top model, you know, and she was involved in this ugly accident, and someone did this for her. They couldn't replant the middle finger, which is proximal to the IP joint. We'll talk about that later, about the when you can use toes, or when I do think toes are a good indication in the fingers. But in this case, you know, there is a you see there is a malunion on the second metacarpal. Okay, they put a plate, but the finger is rotated and also is over lengthened, and you can see there is some base of the metacarpal still preserved, but because she had a web contracture, this is totally useless. And so for her, what we did to restore the web is something funny, which is to harvest the web of the fourth web space here. Okay, and we open the web on the hallux, and the same operation we transpose the fourth metacarpal on top of the fifth metacarpal. We use the screws that I was saying to you before, and we use the web to as a pedicle flap. Also, we connected the vein, but we use the web as a pedicle flap, and then there to the radial digital artery of the small finger, we connected here the hallux. Okay, so this is the operation, the flexor tendon, the nerves here. We release the muscles, because if you release the abductor, you can advance the abductor and restore some function. Okay, so here's the flap. You see the vein. We're going to reconnect the vein because this is too large a flap, and if you have another extra vein, the flap won't suffer at all. And that's the idea of the revascularization. So this is the donor site. I'll talk about the donor site later. And here she is. And here's the function of the hand. And you know, by transposing the fourth metacarpal to the fifth metacarpal, you don't have that deformity that is like a, it makes like a, I don't know how to say that in English, like a wedge. Okay, she's from Denmark. You see, nobody's swimming there because the water must be very cold. But you know, she's at least running. And a bit the same for this type of defects, where you have a combined soft tissue and a hallux defect. I prefer to do this in one stage. This patient had was referred like a week after the accident, and not only we have a soft tissue defect, but also a nerve defect. Okay, so for her, we harvest long, for him, sorry, we harvest through transverse incisions long grafts that go to the carpal tunnel, so we don't have to use interposition nerve graft. And here's the flap, which is a flow through flap. And in that artery and vein, we connected the artery of the hallux and also a vein of the flap. So we use the flap as a vessel carrier. And here's the patient at the time of stitches removal. No other surgery has been done. The flap has not been thin. And here's a patient 2 years after, without any other surgery. We haven't done anything on him. Maybe I should have the fat in here a bit, but here's him doing delicate things and you know, managing pretty well. What about the muscles? Okay, when we have talked about this defect, but when the defect is a bit more proximal, we are going to have problems with the muscle. And if we are losing the thinner muscle, we're going to be in a situation of a median nerve palsy. And if we lose the first, when we lose the first muscle, we're going to be in a situation similar to a ulnar nerve palsy, because we are not going to have any adduction power. Okay, so like a patient like him, we are not going to have opposition. We are not going to have adduction because we need that. Okay, to have function, because the thumb needs seven motors to have a proper function. if there are three joints, okay? That's the CMC, the MCP joint, or the IP joint. You may need only five, but for that you need fusion. You need to fuse the IP joint or the MCP joint. Okay, in that case you can manage with five motors. But if you have less than that, because in some situations there's a dearth of muscles, and then you can be in a situation like a quadriplegia, or tetraplegia, you call it. That then with one flexor, one extensor, you can manage. Okay, you can manage. You can use the CMC joint, you have to fuse the CMC joint and the IP joint, or do a tenodesis here in order to have all your flexor power and your extensor power to the MCP joint. Okay, so I did this classification some time ago, but basically in level one, where if there are still muscles preserved, you can put a skin graft, and that patients function pretty well. In more severe injuries, where all the thinner muscles are gone, you need tendon transfer. Or occasionally, in some situations, you can do also free muscle transfer. This patient comes from a very bad injury. And we did a revascularization of he had a septic crash injury, and but a very bad injury, and he was referred for amputation. But we salvaged that by doing an extensive digitorum brevis flow through free flap to restore. We used the muscle to obliterate the dead space that was infected underneath the flexor tendon, and we connected the dorsalis pedis artery to the superficial palmar arch, and so we were able to restore some function. Okay, but probably that the patient would like more, because he was very eager to have more surgery, and that's his he complained about pinching, and that's his antepulsion, which is not bad, but when he was pinching, the thing collapsed. Okay, the thumb collapsed totally, and that's because for antepulsion he was using the abductor pollicis longus, which is not a muscle that functions during pinching. It's a function that becomes inactive during pinching, so that's why the thumb collapsed. So because he had a motor branch there, and also we had some problems here because this was skin grafted. And so we need first a free flap and then a tendon transfer. There were not so many tendon transfer to be done in this case. We went to the foot and harvest abductor hallucis. This is not an operation of mine that was described by Ibaraki and Kanaya. Kanaya was also co-fellow with Raja Sabapathy and me in Louisville, Fuminori Kanaya. And so they presented this operation that was released in PRS. And so I have done some cases. You only have to harvest the motor branch to this nerve, to this muscle, sorry. Initially, the technique was described with sacrificing the whole medium plantar nerve, but you don't need that. Only with this nerve, the branch that goes to the abductor hallucis is enough. And so here's the patient before and after. So we have connected the motor branch to the abductor of the abductor hallucis to the thinner to the motor branch of the median nerve. Okay, so you see now one important thing is about these transfers is that you have pronation of the thumb, so you have a true pull pinch. And here's the patient doing normal activities. And when stage three and stage four, they're pretty similar because the difference is that you don't have a thumb. So this patient, I saw him as an emergency. He came with a thumb. He was convinced he had a normal thumb. But I tried to explain to him that everything was charred and it was useless. So there was some sensate here and vascularized the ulnar part of the thumb. Okay, so after the debridement, you see there is no thumb, obviously. There's a lack of cover, and we need an opponent plasty and a doctor plasty. So I did this. The first thing I did is to convince the eye he had a problem. So I just let him cool down for 3 or 4 days. And 4 days later, I think we did the reconstruction, and we use a rod through the third workspace, and so he came from the third workspace. That's a burn, so we had to put a skin graft here. But this rod was through the third workspace, and then we was wound around the metacarpal. That's an unvascularized bone graft here, and that's the hallux, Taylor hallux, because this is Taylor hallux, because this is his sensate skin, and this is a lateral unflap that we splitted in the middle so we could cover anteriorly the anterior defect. This is opening plasty. So you can do opposition and adduction transfer at the same time. Maybe you can do it, but it won't work as good. So we delay that for 6 months. Okay, so this is at the end of the operation, and here's the patient 6 months after, and grabbing and pinching a bottle of water, pinch and grasp. But he will have more strength, and the strength is given by the adductor. So we did we used that rod to pass a tendon graft, and we use a Smith adductor plasty with the stens capillaris brevis. Yeah, and here's the patient. This is about 4 kilograms. That's 8 pounds of sand. We have the sand, as Bobak showed. We have the sand in Santander, very close to where we operate. So we went the guy to look for sand, which makes very envy to everybody. Not to the people of San Francisco, because you have the sand also nearby. But here's the patient, 18 months after, doing some pinching. Oh, and the other video doesn't work for some reason. Yeah, he's grabbing and grasping the body. So proximal losses poses even more problems, because you have the problem of the web, you have the problem of the muscles, and you have the problem that you need a long bony structure. Okay, and most of these cases, they are solved in the literature by using a polycization, but I prefer to do otherwise, because people, if in my environment, you know, if you lose a manual worker, if you do a polycization, maybe the hand will function more or less well, but these patients won't be able to go back to work, because they usually they're involving heavy manual workers, heavy manual work, and they won't be able to go to that. And so I offer them a different alternative, which is because to me, I am a Buncke, totally Buncke follower. I think that second toe is a bad option for the thumb, and I am follow Dr. Harry Buncke beliefs or thoughts that the hallux was the best way of reconstructing the thumb. The problem is that if you use the hallux, you will need to sacrifice the first MTP joint, which is not a good idea, because you will have walking problems. So what I've done is to combine this by using the second MTP joint. And you can have as much length as you want, because you have the whole second metatarsal, sorry. And this base, ideally in a dorsal vessel, but I've been very unlucky in this operation. In most of the cases, I have to use the plantar system, because it was not, which complicates a bit more the operation. But anyhow, that's the idea. You know, you have one very important thing is that you don't have Fouché used to say that this version, he twisted the MTP joint. And that's a big mistake, because the joint becomes unstable. If you put the joint the other way around, and so they will have, I don't know if you can see me, but they will have more flexion, because the MTP joint moves more in flexion. But it will be unstable sidewise. Okay, it will be unstable in this direction. So don't do that. Okay, the joint has to be anatomically. So rather than a twisting, it's a sifting. We shift this part on here. So the dorsal part is always dorsal part, okay? And so you see here how the vessel goes underneath from the whatever the vessel is, first plantar, first dorsal, metatarsal, and then goes to the hallux. That's important at the time of planning because usually you plan to harvest the artery that goes to the ulnar because that's where the vessels are. And if you do this operation, you have to harvest the hallux from the contralateral side. Otherwise, this artery will end up radial, which is not a problem, but it's just one important thing that you have to consider. Okay, donor side, one thing we did is to transfer the proximal phalanx of the second toe, on top of the first first phalanx of the large toe. And in most cases, we use like a flap, the tongue flap that we use to reduce the hallux. We put it here to make larger second toe. And here's the patient, one of them. You see that the way it looks after the hallux transfer, that looks it's not a perfect hallux and the toe where you live, but it's much better what I used to do for my patients. Okay, this patient is also mine before we start to do this operation. Okay, so let's go back to the case. That's the way we do this in a table. That's the artery and the vein. And one important thing that I publish in the PRS is that you have to do this operation early, because if you do it early, maybe in the first 2 months, you will be able to use even remnants from the adductor pollicis, mobilize them from the first metacarpa, and these muscles will work, okay? If you wait too long, you do a groin flap and you wait 3 months or something like that to mature, that will be just a scar tissue. You won't be able to use it and you will need many more tendon transfer. Okay, so this the patient, adductor pollicis here, suture, is going to function properly. And we use the, because there was no extensor pollicis longus, it was a bulge from the injury. We did this tendon transfer and we use an iliac flap, which is a flap I like a lot. This is location of the groin flap, which is more medial. And if you go more lateral, the iliac flap is very thin. Even not overweight, but heavy people, still the flap is very thin and can be thin actually. So here's the flap without any modification. And so these are the end of the operation. So we have three free flaps, but we were able to do this. Okay. And here's the patient and the function, okay. And you see the guy he works in a farm and he's back going back to work. I mean, he's he sent me a video of riding his tractor and also riding his motorcycle. He doesn't like to do no mountain bike, whatever, motocross, whatever it's called. And but I don't know where I have that, those videos somewhere in my computer. We can even do more proximal amputation. Okay, this is a case who has already been operated elsewhere. They have done a posterior interosseous flap here. They have done a fusion, wrist fusion. The scaphoid is still here. Actually, it's here. It's, the hand is a bit, as you can see, there is not well aligned, but people operate sometimes, you know, they have danger. They are more dangerous than the injury. But so for this case, I guess that most people would think that the best thing would be to do a pollicization. But this guy is a sailor. He actually is a captain of a fishing boat, big one. You know, it's a big one. They fish in the middle of the Atlantic, and he had a fall in the boat. I don't know. He had a fascia trauma. he had this bad injury in his hand, and he would like to go back to work. Okay, so if you do, in my view, if you do a polarization, these guys, they're not going to go back to work. Actually, they in Spain, they have to pass some medical assessments, and they won't allow them. They won't allow him to go back to the fishing because they have quite strict rules there. So he would like to go back to work, and so and he didn't like to do a polarization. So we were a good combination. So I did this operation for him, the same as I was telling you before, and we use in this case I use a gracilis to cover all that, and we put fuse the second metatarsal to the trapezoid. The scaphoid actually is not here. That's something the artist did, but the scaphoid is gone, and there is a wrist fusion, and we treat that because as you can see here, he had a bad injury also in the flexor tendon, so we didn't have much to use. So we treat him as a tetraplegia, because we had this joint fuse. So I did a tenodesis of the IP joint of the hallux, and we used the second MCP joint for as a some flexion here. Okay, there's no carpal tunnel either. It's a disaster case. And this is where the nerves are. There's no radial artery either. So for this case, to vascularize this one, that's a doctor again, Dr. Buncke, my hero, one of my heroes, Dr. Taylor, a doctor who I trained with Taylor. And by the way, he was very close friend. And he was always mentioning to Buncke, to Harry Buncke, to that. And that's Dr. Buncke who described this to make a transverse incision here. And that's the transverse incision we need to have a long nerve graft, long nerve pedicles, that's vascularized. And we only did this incision here and have this long flexoalluses. So this is the these are complex flap because it's the hallux, and this is the second MTP joint. And on top of that, we did a gracilis, and because we didn't have a radial artery, we didn't have anything at all. You're going to think I'm crazy, which maybe I am, but we used the fourth web vessel here, first common digital artery, and we flipped that and connected the, as you can see here, the gracilis and the thumb reconstruction. We connected that to this vessel because we needed the own artery was working. And so here's this beautiful drawing that my artist did for me. You see, this is the gracilis, the reconstruction of the flexor and extensor tendons, and the fusion. Okay, and here's the patient 9 weeks after the surgery, and here's the patient 8 months after, and that's where he, let's get a bit stuck, but remember we have he's able to touch the middle finger. We only have one joint, which is the second TP joint, but the guy went back to his work, which is what he would like to. I think this is the last picture. Yeah, this is the last picture of the thumb. I don't know if you want to ask me some questions, or you want me to go to keep going, or you are really bored, or whatever.
Yeah, I think what we'll do is we'll have some questions and comments on this portion, and then we have some extra time. We'll go to one of your other topics. First off, I think it's readily evident the mastery of Paco's work, and I think for the residents and fellows who are on this webinar, I think it really shows the level of thought that goes into doing these very very elegant reconstructions, and it's not just putting a toe on a thumb, but addressing the web space. Thinking about the joints, thinking about how much function you're going to have from a sensation standpoint, from a tendon reconstruction standpoint. And what you see is really the full spectrum of hand surgery here that Paco has shown in a very brief talk. Shows experience from decades and decades of masterful surgery. Greg, I'm going to have you, if you can unmute yourself, kind of as the head of the Buncke Clinic. I thought maybe you would have maybe some comments and questions for Paco's incredible work.
I am just amazed, Paco. Thank you so much for showing us these incredible cases, and actually tons of new ideas that we're going to be utilizing right away. I hope you don't mind, because they're all great ideas. I mean, the idea of using part of the second toe metatarsal and the proximal phalanx of the second toe, we've always taken either the whole great toe down to the tarsal metatarsal joint. And I agree that it's a pretty ugly looking foot afterwards. It functions relatively well. And we've also used fibula as a metacarpal. But this is a very nice, what you've described is a very nice, and you're doing the secondary soft tissue reconstruction, either gracilis, or these are all done simultaneously, I assume. They're two microvascular transplants at the time. Yes, is that correct?
Yes. Everything is done at the same time. I published that in PRS last year, so but I can give you more details of the technique. Actually, we start to do this in when actually the starting of doing toe closure was to have this the possibility of reconstructing proximal thumbs. So that's, we started to do this in 2004. So we have now like 10 cases or something. It works pretty well. Okay. The problem is that you need to have enough number of tendons. Otherwise, you need to fuse joints. Otherwise, the thing will be collapsed. So you need to do. You need to think of the tendons that you have. I think donor size is much better than.
And I can tell. So I have just some specific questions. You mentioned the extensor digitorum brevis muscle as a tendon transfer, which I think is a great idea. We've used it a few times. Do you have any tricks? Every time we've done it, we've had some problems with skin loss over the dorsum of the foot. Have you had any issues with that? And if so, have you got any tricks to avoid that?
So you mean harvesting the extensor digitorum brevis?
Yes.
No, I've done many of those because I published that. That was probably my first paper in PRS 20 years ago. I've done maybe 50. You know, but so not really. I haven't had any problem with that with the skin.
It seemed like there were more problems if it was a very dorsal dominant system, where the skin blood supply was based off of the dorsal system, so that you're taking away that vessel that was supplying the skin, and oftentimes we get a lot of marginal necrosis. You did not get that then?
No, actually I haven't, but I'm not,
you do a better job somehow. I don't know what we're doing wrong.
You know, maybe I've been lucky, but actually I've done many times to raise what I call the dorsalis pedis fascia subcutaneous flap. You know, you only have, for example, the toe and a fascia subcutaneous extension. Now, those cases, you take just the dermis, and you leave the dermis, right? In those cases, you take a too large flap, then you have a skin sufferance and you get necrosis. But these defects, they heal very nice. Yeah. I mean, they tell the patient, you know, it's going to take you 2 months to heal. You know, don't go to the beach or do whatever, but I don't know. But the extensor digitorum brevis, actually, I haven't had problems with that.
Yeah. Good.
How do you decide when to trim the gray toe or fatten the second toe? It looked like you were doing something. How did you do that? You made the second toe bigger once you moved it over to the great toe spot.
I only do that if the hallux is too large. Okay.
Yeah.
So if the hallux is too large, I do a kind of a tail here. I take a tail from this side, and that's where I use that tail to increase the girdle of the second toe.
Yeah.
But if the hallux is fine, if the first toe, the great toe is fine, I would prefer to have a nice thumb than a nice second toe in the foot. I don't know if that makes sense.
It does.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, so because sometimes people, they have enormous great toes, you know, so you need to reduce that, and that a bit like Fushan way, you know, like a reduction of the remove that tail, but so I also remove a bit of bone, and that allows me to close. But I much prefer to have a nice thumb than a nice second toe.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to use, I don't do, you know, make sense that?
Yes, yep. Definitely. I wanted to ask the audience if there's anyone with a pressing question, feel free to unmute yourself and ask. If not, we'll give you a few seconds to do that. And then if not, we can talk about next topic while people are getting ready. Paco, I think you and I discussed at length when I was with you in Spain last December, but your concept of the acceptable hand, I think is a really interesting topic. And I think shows a lot of very kind of elegant thought in what goes into a hand that basically is acceptable from a functional standpoint. Okay. So if you do have, I know you do have a talk on that, and I want to be respectful of the time in light of the time change, but maybe if you can touch on that, I think our viewers would definitely benefit from that.
You know, I used to talk somewhere. But yeah,
if not, we can do the metacarpal hand.
No, it's fine. No problem.
Okay.
But I was looking for it. Yeah, I was looking for it in my, you know, because I'm not so good in these things.
No problem.
So
while you're looking for that, I'm just going to tell the.
I found it.
You found it. Okay.
Any question?
You should still have presenter controls, so you can. You should be able to share your screen again.
Yeah. In search of the acceptable hand. Okay.
Perfect.
This is it.
Yeah.
So this is supposed to be working. Yeah. Okay. Search of the acceptable hand. Yeah. This is a thing I've been working on that. You know my. First paper was 2002, something like that. Because at the time I was doing toe transfer, most of the indications were for thumb, you know, as a case I showed you before. But there were very, very little papers talking about how to reconstruct the fingers. And really, the problem of the fingers when you have a is not only that you have to restore as many as you can, but also you have to restore the arcade of the hand, because otherwise the hand looks crooked and is very ugly and doesn't function properly. The problem is that with the toes, this is the guy, patient I have with the longest ever toes I've seen, but it's still shorter as you can imagine, it's much shorter than his fingers. Okay, so I devised this specification. This was published actually before in PRS 2002, I think, but which I made this specification. And the important thing is that we all want to be normal, but a good idea was to find what I call the acceptable hand, which is a hand with has three fingers and a thumb and motion at the level of the PAP joint. And that's a bit to talk about. Okay, so how do I decide all this? Basically, the important thing is what is going on the PIP joint. Because if the PIP joint is functional or is reconstructable, and if it is even one just finger missing, and the patient is fit, I tell the patient, you know, we can do a toe transfer for you. Okay, because the alternative is that if there is only one finger damaged and the PAP joint is irreconstructible or is damaged or is lost, then my option will be a reverse section. Okay, obviously I won't do that when there are two fingers, but when there is just one, I advise, and I don't do actually a second toe. for those cases. So very rarely, maybe once, but very rarely, but that would be the norm. And the important thing, again, if you do a reconstruction, is that you have to restore the archaic. Okay, this patient is fortunate and unfortunate. So it's fortunate because he was unfortunate because he was born with this injury, mallet finger congenital, and it was bothering him, so he was in the waiting list for having this second toe amputated. But he was lucky because the waiting list for this is very long, so he has been in the waiting list like 3 or 4 years, and in the meantime he sustained these injuries. Believe it or not, this is done in a university hospital, and they put back the fingers, this is 20 years ago or more maybe, but they put back the fingers, they stitched them, put some silk sutures, hoping that the thing was going to vascularize or something, which it didn't, obviously. And so, because we have that toe, we harvest that second toe, put it here, we harvest another second toe and a flap, and this is the patient 3 months after the injury, and this is this was 2003 PRS. This 5 years, the function. And if you this patient, they have even they have FTP, so they have this. He's a Mason, and he's as normal grip on a similar to the other side. This patient is a bit different because she had this injury in a gratter, and so we couldn't replant anything. You see she had a fracture here. Also this case like 20 years ago, and she had this middle finger amputated proximal to the PIP joint. Okay, and we stabilized minimally the fracture. It was a Friday night. I remember it was a Friday night because they sent me for replantation on a Friday night at 1 a.m. I said, look, you know, they must be joking because everything was like a gratter. You know, it was a bread gratter. I don't know if that's correct. But anyway, so that's on a Tuesday. So 4 days later, I did a reconstruction. And move the index finger, and at the same time we transpose the second toe on top of the index finger, which is now in the middle finger position. And this hair 1 year, even with the PIP joint, which was fractured. And he's 10 years later. That's she was operated 20 years ago. But the important thing is that the arcade is restored. This patient is a special patient because he's a manual worker. You see he has callus everywhere. He's a Mason. And in the area where I lived, where I used to live, I live now in Madrid, but I used to live in a small town. I was well known for my toe transfer. And so I said to the patient that I was going to do a reconstruction. And the patient said, no, you're going to do a toe transfer. I said, no, that's your case. At that time, I was not so convinced. Maybe it's 25 years ago. I don't know. Long time ago. And I was not so convinced that this was a good operation. And the patient said, look, if I lose my index finger, and this is my right hand, I won't be able to grip my heavy stuff. And so I need to do that because I'm a young guy and I need this for. So he convinced me. So he told me, we're going to do a second toe. So, because he had a PIP joint, I thought that was a good idea. But you know, just to be the man who lead the show, who ran the show, I told him, you know, I'm not gonna do a second toe because your second toe is awful. I'm gonna do a third toe. So I have as the third toe. And in order to restore the arcade, we put an interposition bone graft in this case. From the foot somewhere, and this is him a year after, and again this is a very old case. This is 1 year, and you see the IP joint. So I'm gonna put it again. You see the IP joint moves normally. He's using the thumb for everything. Okay, I threw the pen for him, and he grabbed it without any difficulty. The problem is when patients come like that, okay? These are patients we saw in emergency, you see already the PI pigeons are gone. In those cases, obviously we don't do a two-phase resection, we do total transfer, but knowing that this patient, the motion on the IP joint is going to be fused. Okay, so these fingers, they don't move very nice. I mean, she's happy with the toes. I'm not so much, but the funny thing is that she works, went back to his work, and he has a very good grip strength, as good as nearly as the other hand. But the problem is a problem of motion. So one thing I want to stress is that this situation is in some cases preventable. If you are seeing child patients, the people who are young and they are, and you are thinking of doing toe transfer, don't resect the bases of the proximal funnel, because this was the original injury. And there's nothing wrong, by the way, in this, because all the book says that the proximal to the FDS, you should remove these bits because they are going to be unstable. But actually, if you are thinking of doing those, the situation totally changed from this situation to this, because we know that from experience that that even damaged bases of the middle phalanx, like this case, you know, there are fractures. This patient had a sore injury. There are fracture here, another fracture here, and even the PA pigeon here is damaged. But we use that for putting second toe transfer, and you see that the situation is totally different to the other patient I showed you before, because there is motion at the level of the PA pigeon. So this is a patient who comes from. I've been receiving some patients from the war of Middle East, and this is the original injury, and he's happy probably because he's still alive, but he had a bad injury on his hand, and so that's the end result of his initial treatment. And this screw probably is the only one they had here, but the PAP joint is nailed here, it's totally useless. Probably they have a fracture here, and they put this screw. She's a non-cannulated screw that destroyed the PIP joint. He also had a malunion. He had no sensibility here in the thumb. So we wanted to, I told him that the first priority was to restore the thumb, to correct the malunion, to do a thumb. And my idea was to resect this and in order to restore the, and to put here a transfer. But this guy because it was very important to remove this thing here, because it was creating a quadriga effect, okay? And it was impairing the function of their whole hand. But these guys, they are not, you know, they don't speak your language, they need a translator, and they are not very, they don't trust very much in doctors, European doctors. So he was not very convinced that I should remove this part of him. So he allowed me to do the hallux, and I've done a bunch of those patients. So really he came quite convinced to have the surgery, but he allowed me to do the hallux, and he allowed me to do the second toe, but he waited for a week before he allowed me to remove this one, the ray, which usually I would have done it in the same operation, but here it is, okay, at the end of the operation. So we came from this arcade to this other arcade, and from this function, you see there's no good flexion because there's a quadriga effect from this middle finger and to this situation where you see the small finger now bends normally, and we have just done secondary surgery to improve the nail and so on in this finger, but the function was much improved. So the important thing of the metacarpal head is that even in the middle of the worst situation you can imagine, you have to think of that, because even in metacarpal head, that works the same way. This patient came with apparently a nice amputation, meta kappa level, so it's going to be a nice case, but the problem is the other part, that everything is, you know, all the flexor tendons are gone, above, so we didn't have any flexor tendon, but we have this bit, which actually, I thought, why are you going to do to this patient? You know, the only thing you can do is to transfer. So this lacked a second toe. So I put a second toe. I put the index finger here. This is the PIP. I was pointing with my finger. This is the PIP joint here. So we 5 days later, I put a second toe. This patient is about, I don't know, maybe 20 years ago, he told me, and he is one, patients open you ideas, they give you ideas. At that time, a tripod hand was perfect. But he told me, you know, this hand is not going to look normal because I may only have 2 fingers. So I think that I want to have another one. So look, but that doesn't make sense. No, but it makes sense to me because, so he made me think that he was right. So I put him another toe a week later. So this is 5 days after the injury. This is a week afterwards, so 12 days. And here's the patient, okay? With the arcade, which is restored, the fingers are much shorter, but it's regular, you know, and the hand doesn't look too bad. And we only have one flexor tendon for all this. Don't tell me how the guy can do independent job, but he is doing now. Some, you see, obviously when both hands are together, it's very obvious, but we haven't been able to restore function. So this thing made me change my mind and to go from the tripod hand to what I call the tripod plus hand. But you can use that when there are more than 2 toes, or when you can harvest 3 toes sometimes. This is, I don't know if the surfers, they do like this in your country, but in my country, they do like this, you know, when they are surfing. So this is a surfer hand, but the guy was actually, he's a smart guy. He's a teacher, but he was doing some job he was not supposed to be doing, and he had this bad injury. And for him, we did 2 toes. I think Jim Higgins was in the operation when he was visiting me some time ago. And we did this, and he's the patient. You know, the donor side is much, much better than if you remove a second and third toe, much better. And he's using normal shoes. And that's a shame because the picture is unfocused, but you can see the difference from what we have to what we have been achieved. And here's the patient. So this is our MTP gen, sorry. So this is the second MTP gen, and he can do that. He had a video that I haven't been able to find where he's actually using his fingers to hook, to make the knot in a hook of fishing, because he loves fishing. But I don't know where I have that video. And this principle of acceptable hand, sometimes you have to give we have to accept you have to accept the situation that you may not be able to give a perfect acceptable hand because there is no possibility of giving most of the PIP joint. But she's a 70-something. Patient, and she has been wearing cosmetic prosthesis because supposedly she was too old to have the surgery. I operated on this patient more than 15 years ago, and I was very much criticized at the beginning because people in meetings thought that it was crazy to do a surgery to transfer in a 70 years old patient or 70 something. So there was a plastic surgery meeting, so I asked them. So you think that it's contraindicated to do surgery on a 70-year-old patient? Also, facelift is contraindicated in a 70-year-old lady because, you know, I don't know why they are not fit for surgery for a toe transfer and they are fit for surgery for a facelift. So that with that argument, I convinced them that it was, provided the patient is fit, it is a good option. So she has, as you can see, some problems with the site that she put more more polish in the shoe than in the second toe, but she wanted to be nice at the time of the my first consultation. So we did a very resection and we put that toe here, knowing that it was not going to function very nicely, but at least was going to put a good cosmetic aspect to the hand. But the lady came back 6 months later with this range of motion at the level of the PIP chain. Okay. So some people, they are very hard workers and really much better than what we see here. This is some time ago, as you can see, it's August 2018. I've done now more than 500 toes and three failures. I will talk about failures in a moment if I have time. This concept of the acceptable hand is very important that you keep it in mind, not only if you are doing toes, but also in every situation. This patient, as you can see, he has a huge one loss here from maybe the finger. He has also a bad injury at the level of the index finger. So once we restore the length of this middle finger, we're going to have soft tissue defect, a bone defect, and also we're going to have a problem at the level of the middle finger. Index finger. Okay, with the joint exposed, and I've been still not very radically deprived, and I just remove a bit the crust, and the IP joint already is here. Okay, so how to restore that without using the toes? Well, we had first metacarp, no, first proximal phalanx of the small finger. So we did this. We did as a free flap. We used the bone, and also use the ball up part of the proximal phalanx skin of the small finger to cover this defect like a cross finger flap. Okay, so here's the bone, and then we divided that, and this is some time ago. Also, you know, most of these cases, they are more than 15 years old, but because now I will transpose this metacarp into here, so the hand looks better, it doesn't make like this notch here. Okay, you see the hand I showed you before looks much nicer than this one. But here's the patient and the function. And he was a joiner, a carpenter, and he will come back to his work. So important take home messages are that the importance of the acceptable hand. You can't get this in many different ways, but and sometimes you may be able to get a normal hand in multiple amputation. This patient had this level of injury, and we did we transferred the second toe and also the distal hallux. And here's the function, you see, with good IP joint motion of the thumb and good function of the index finger. You know, when I was a young surgeon, they used to criticize the toes because they said that they didn't get good sensibility and they were useless and so on, but actually the truth is that they work very, very well. But this is the most important message, yeah? Okay, if you are thinking of doing a patient is fit to do to transfer, I urge you to keep these bits of bone. Even if you are in the middle of nowhere, you know, don't resect those bones because you are not going to do a good favor to your patient. Because if someone else or yourself can do a toe transfer, you will be able to use this to plant here your toe, and it's going to have a good motion, very good motion at the level of the PIP joint. Okay, and I think this is it from my acceptable hand. I don't know if that's what you wanted or.
Paco, that is fantastic. Always amazed when I hear your talks, and I think that's one of the many reasons that we wanted you to share your experience with us, is for folks to be able to see the incredible work that you do. And I think one of the important things about your work on the acceptable hand is, and we always talk about this, is to really think beyond that initial operation. If the initial operation, you want to close all the wounds, then you're more likely to remove those little bits and pieces of bone or remnants of the PIP joint. And you may not think ahead, and you may burn the important bridges that you need in the future. And so I think for all the trainees out there, I think the important thing to take away from this talk, well, many important things, but one of them is to really have a long-term strategy and be able to kind of think beyond that first step to plan a very elegant reconstruction, many of which you've seen today. Greg, do you have any comments or questions?
Always. Thank you again. This is fantastic. It's really a, we're so lucky that we have a recording of this because you've given us so much information. I'm have to go through it piece by piece. I hope you don't mind that we keep the recording.
Dan, how are you? Thank you for joining us. Sorry, Greg.
Quick question. Finish Are you doing many secondary operations like tenolysis and capsulotomies to get more motion after you've done toe transplants?
No, I try not to do anything. Actually, no. The answer is no. I need to go back to where I've been. You know, actually, my operations are, I try to be very safe, even if you think I may be very risky. You know, I try to keep the function of the hand, the flexor and so on in this toe transfer. Most of the motion is PIP joint. Maybe the DIP joint doesn't move too much, the DIP, but I don't care. I prefer not to go into more trouble. And also, these patients, they are, many of my patients, they are workers. And if you start to do surgery, another surgery, another surgery, you end up transforming them in chronic handicap, and they don't go back to work, you know? Unless you, I try to say, I see them, you know, one day, I say, look, I'm going to do this operation, and in 6 weeks, you're going to start, or 4 weeks, whatever, you're going to start to move. And in 3 months, they're going to feel much better, and we will do a strengthening exercises for the next 2 months, and they're going to go back to work. Because if you start, I am a private doctor, and if you, I want to have the patients go back to work, because if my surgery is supposed to be better, because I offer better things that to do an amputation or to, you know, insurances, and I'm going to talk about money now, insurances, won't be very nice if you they spend a number of dollars in an operation will end up patient not working. So yeah. to make everything happy, you know, the patient, the insurance, and me. I mean, usually the patient has to be happy. You know, sometimes you have to do operation that you know that the patient is not going to work, but you have to do it because the patient deserves that. But I try to be, I try to be like the police officer, trying to not to give anything to the insurance, but not to give anything to the patient that's not deserved. The insurance, they make a big effort to send me the patient because I'm an expensive guy. I'm not American, but I'm an expensive guy, and the idea is that they send it to me because I'm worthwhile, and I'm worthwhile because I think in the best for the patient first of all, but also in the best for the insurance. But first of all, the patient, okay? But so if the patient start to make I want this, turn it around, I say, look, this is the end of the game. You go back to work. This is it.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Maybe the patient, if I do a tenolysis, they may get. First of all, you know, tenolysis in workers, in general, tenolysis in workers, they don't work very well, even in very patient is a motivated patient, which I wouldn't say is the norm. The norm is not to be that motivated. Patients who prefer, they're very lazy. We are lazy, we in general, or lazy. So we end up going to the lawyer that will start to give us idea of how not to work, and that will be bad for the patient because the patient to go to work. That's where we are more healthy. Now that we are in lockdown, we know what is be in home for so many weeks that we have to go back to work, all of us. So that's bad for the patient, it's bad for the insurance, and it's bad for the country. So I tried to push them into going back to activities.
Looks like we have Dan Zadala from CHOP with us. Dan, did you have a question or comment for Paco?
No, not really. I just want to say as a comment that having visited you, and I'm sure that many here have gone to visit you, it's impressive actually how selective, and you alluded to this, how selective you are in who you're operating on. And I think that's something that doesn't necessarily come across when you show this sort of wide breadth of cases, is that there are many patients that come in specifically for a certain procedure that they may have seen you do or heard about you do, but you're fairly selective about who you choose as a patient who would really benefit from that. And I think that is what you were commenting on about you know, being respectful to the payer and to the insurance company and to the patient themselves. So kudos to that.
Well, thank you. Yeah, I think that, you know, you cannot, you know, if a patient, I don't do operations, you know, I try to fix patients. If the operation I'm thinking of, you know, because the operation that benefits that the patient won't benefit the patient, I don't do it because I have plenty of patients, and I don't want to have, because this patient in the end, they will be dissatisfied. Mm-hmm. You know, in one way or another, they will be dissatisfied. So it's much better to be sure that your patient is going to understand what you want to do for them, because you know, you realize that they end up not being happy, you know. So there is it's better just to get rid of them, you know, not to operate on them. I mean, it's if you think that the benefit is not going to be so much, you know, just to do surgery on for fun or for money or for whatever is not going to be good. That's, yeah. I guess that's what you want to be.
Yeah. And the other question I have is for the young surgeons who are starting out, and for those of us who've been in practice and are awed by what you're doing, do you have a suggestion as to where to begin in your practice when you want to start doing these kinds of procedures? What specifically, which kinds of procedures do you think should be sort of your gateway into getting into this kind of reconstructive ladder?
Well, yeah, obviously not total transfer, because total transfer, there are not that many totals. So I would think that the best way to have experience is by replantation. Replantation gives you the opportunity to deal with the small vessels in bad conditions and so on. But I think there is only one trick. Okay, is study, and the more you study, the more tricks you know, the more you can deal with difficult situations. I you know, although I have only three failures, that doesn't mean I don't suffer every now and then, you know, and sometimes I struggle. And I don't know how long we have, but I want to finish with a couple of cases where you see that even if having a lot of experience, sometimes you can be into trouble, and you have to be able to put the patient first. I'm sure most of you most of you guys to put the patients first, but some people, they just think operate is something that, you have to cut something, And I said, I have a sentence that said that operate is very easy. If you think it's to operate well, that's a operate is very easy. Not everybody can do it. To operate right, to have a result, and to sort of guarantee or to an outcome is what is difficult. Okay, so because I don't know many of the people who is around. I mean, I know Rudy Buncke and many other. I think Jeff is also around, but. I would like to show you some cases just to see how things go sometimes for super masters, because sometimes things are not easy. I'm gonna show you a nice case, okay, difficult, nice case. I'm gonna look for my screen. Where are we? I lost my.
You're down below.
Are you seeing my screen?
We're not, but down below there's a screen button.
Yeah. Okay. I found it. Don't worry. Okay. Okay. Now I have to find the talk. So this one, I think it's this one. Yeah. Okay. So this is a difficult case. I'm going to finish with that. So. Okay. This is a patient is 40 something. And it was had a groin flap here. Vertical groin flap, the amputation is at the level of the wrist. And so I told the guy told me he didn't like a prosthesis. And when I saw him at the fighters, I told him, I think we can offer you something. Okay. So I detached the hand from the groin. And that's the scaphoid, that's the lunate. And flexor tendons were cut here because someone divided that. And what we did is, although this is not a flap as my fever at all, but we, instead of to throw it away, we dissect the groin vessels. Okay, that's the groin vessels. So we dissect the other side of the flap. That's the superficial circumflex iliac artery and veins. And so we put a toe transfer here and wrap the whole thing with this chunky flap, but much better than to throw it away. Okay. And that's him here. And that's 5 days after the injury. This is a week after we did a second and third tooth on top of the lunate, the scaphoid. And he's 1 year.
That's awesome.
That's incredible.
That's incredible.
Amazing. Yeah.
Yeah, but.
Yeah,
okay, so you can
please go ahead.
So and he has about 7 kilos of pinch strength, and he's here using his that's Santander beach. Okay, that's a very important beach of Santander. And I didn't know that I have this case, but this guy also has a similar injury. He did pretty much the same, and here he is. Doing bimanual activities without taking any medication or anything. Okay. And he's using the trigger with this tripod hand. I have nothing to do with the dress code of the guy, but okay. And one thing I would like to talk is about donor site, because this is the patient I've taken more of. Other, but this is one of the most of the thing I've taken most, which is a hallux from one side and second and third toe from the other. But this is the original injury, okay? And people criticize a lot the donor site, but provided you stay, you limit the amount of things that you take, they can function pretty well. This is 4 months after. You see the hand is here, and he's playing soccer. That's the one that he's the one that moves. That's his brother. And here he is, him 4 months after the injury.
Amazing.
Let me see if it is moves. So this is with more toes, but this last year. This is a patient I would like to show you, because for the younger people, it's important. This is like my 300th thought transfer or something like that. I've done already 300 by this patient. So this is never operated before. And I tell the patients to, the parents, to put this as a pedicle flap on top of this and to use some C plastic or something like that, you know, basically basic surgery in order to avoid toes and to create a three-finger hand, okay? But they told me that they would like to have their daughter with four fingers. And so I devised this operation in one to do like a boomerang flap, harvesting this part of the middle finger and using a non-vascularized bone graft with a growth plate from the toe in this position for the index, and the same operation to connect the second toe here. Okay, so this is the operation. Everything went fine. This is the flap on the index finger, and this is at the end of the operation. Everything perfect, no problem. The surgery was going to be scheduled 1 year later, but the parents said that it was better to do it sooner. So at 6 months, no trouble. For me, we did the second stage, which was the same reverse. Okay, we used the groin, the filleted flap from the ring finger to correct the glenodactyly and to put a non-vascularized bone graft with growth plate here, okay, and a tool. Same operation. We started, that's a common thing that people don't understand very well, but usually I start my toe transfer in the afternoon, late afternoon, 4 p.m., 5 p.m. sometimes, even later. And in another slide, there was my case, but I think there's 300 and something case, number 300. So this is 8 p.m., okay? So 8 p.m., we have done everything. The toe, we have reduced the size of this one. Greg, sometimes we do that. I try not to do tenolysis and things like that. The pulp or the nail, we do sometimes eponychial flaps. So this is at the end of the operation, 8 p.m., everything went fine, everything picked up immediately. So I went home, and this is the connection. We connected the first plantar metatarsal arch because there was a plantar dominant, which is okay, actually. Actually, it's better for this type of reconstruction to use the first plantar metatarsal arch because the artery is also palmar. Okay, so I'm connected to the common digital arch. But they called me 1 a.m. of the same day. So it's Wednesday night, Wednesday. That was a Tuesday, Wednesday, a.m. 1 a.m. they called me, and because the toe was white. So I did a bit of massage. The same time the anesthesiologist put an axillary block and a bit of massage there, and the thing picked up and nice. Okay, so I went home a bit more worried because you like to have problems with your patients, particularly if it is a kid, because a patient that is some age, you can put him on the local or whatever, but these guys, or this at this age, you have to put them on the general anesthesia, otherwise they won't tolerate anything. So we did the general anesthesia and the axillary block. So this 1 a.m., I got home maybe 3. Or four, I can't remember, three. I was going to fall asleep and they called me again, 6 a.m. Now I'm sleeping the whole night. Okay, so this is because the finger or the toe was pale. So this time I opened that up, redid the anastomosis, couldn't find anything, but I just put some heparin there. And so I went, I had the whole surgery in the morning, or maybe clinic in the morning, more clinic in the afternoon. I finished by 7 p.m. I went to see the patient. And it was everything okay. You know, I could see pink color, nice, Doppler okay. And I went to bed early. It's not normal to go to bed at 9 p.m. in Spain, but I went to bed at that earlier. I went to bed. I just plunged into the bed, and they called me again. The finger was better. I said, "Look, it's impossible. I've been there 2 hours ago." Less than 2 hours ago. No, come. It was one of the guys, so I went immediately, and the finger was pale. Okay, so this time I did a revised anastomosis, which I couldn't find anything. I reconnected the fibula, digital artery, to one branch of the that's the branch that goes to the hallux. Okay, so this is the first plantar metatarsal artery. That's the branch that goes to the hallux. I hear so hallux branch, peroneal digital artery. Okay, and here's the patient, the finger, beautiful. Okay, so this that's Wednesday night without any sleep, the whole day been working. That's the problem of private practice. I guess that you also suffer that every now and then. And that's what I could go home maybe at 3 a.m. and just sleep for 4 hours. Thursday the toe was perfect. I went to see the patient maybe 4 times during the day. I went to see her on Friday, and Saturday, it says Friday, but it's Saturday, 4 a.m. they call me again. So it's 80 hours after the surgery. And they call me again because the finger was again pain. So this time I said, look, this is the end of the game. I went to the foot and I have the dorsalis pedis artery, and I went, I did a end-to-end connection of the ulnar artery, and then here to this first plantar metatarsal artery. Okay, like this, but I use an arterial graft, and this is the end of the story. You know, fortunately the thing, so after the fourth revision, the thing went fine and didn't have any trouble. But I want to stress this because even if you have a lot of experience, sometimes you have to suffer like a dog. To suffer like a dog is correct, like suffer like something, like a lot. But we were able to restore from this hand to this other arcade. And he doesn't play piano, you know, but he's just a... I don't know how to say tapping there, but you see, he's using her hand normal. She doesn't hide it, and we were able to give her what we wanted. But I would like to stress that life is not easy for us either. Okay, and I don't know if that's enough.
Yeah,
or is that enough?
That's incredible. Paco, thank you so much for inspiring all of us, not just the residents and fellows, but also us as well. Every time we chat, and one of the best parts of visiting you was just sitting down and just talking about cases. And I think it's nice to kind of see the thought process. And also it's past midnight Madrid time now. So I thank you so much for sharing your experience with us.
I got some questions, you know, so there's no problem. Yeah. If you want some questions or whatever, I'm happy.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. It's been fantastic. And I look forward to seeing you in person soon, hopefully.
Okay.
It's great.
Thanks. Have a good day.
Thanks so much, Paco.
Bye.
Stay out of the family. Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye, Dan.